Hi, everyone. Thank you for joining us today on HR Hospitality from Happy Valley Station, located in State College, Pennsylvania. My name is Evan Kraft, and I'm a junior in the Professional Golf Management program here at Penn State.
Thank you, Evan. My name is Avery Clarke, and I am a junior hospitality student. A fact about me is that after graduation from Penn State, I plan to move to New York City.
Hi, everyone. My name is Corryn Castello, and I'm a junior studying hospitality management at Penn State. I was always interested in travel and the travel industry, so when I found the hospitality program at Penn State, I knew it was a perfect fit for me.
Welcome. My name is Alexa Keegan. I'm a passionate third-year student studying hospitality management and business at Penn State. Something interesting about me is I hope to work in human resource industry in the future.
Hey, everyone. I am Abby Woods, and I'm a senior in hospitality management. Something interesting about me is I want to start up my own events company one day. For today's podcast, we'll be hearing from each of our members' desks. Evan will be reporting from the Hear Something Cool desk. Avery has Hear Something Important. Corryn is Hear Something Innovative. Alexa's Hear Something Everyone Should Care About. And you'll hear from me last with Hear Something to Watch Out For. Now let's get started with the news.
Hello again. Like I mentioned before, my name is Evan, and today I will be reporting from the Hear Something Cool desk. My purpose today is to kind of jumpstart this podcast with more of a fun tone, but make sure it relates to the human resources realm. So the article I'm going to be talking about is titled The Resurrection of the Office Phone Call from the Wall Street Journal. This article was written by Krithiga Varagur on November 27th, 2020. One thing cool about this article is it goes well with people our age, people who are just joining the workforce. It discusses how people during the pandemic have found that the now old phone calls are actually fitting their legs. Obviously, people can't meet in person as much as Zoom has allowed, but Zoom has become very prevalent. Sometimes that can be visually overwhelming, so this article talks about how the phone call is a perfect substitute for getting the job done without being overwhelmed. The article also gives statistics showing the increase in phone calls over this time. It says that AT&T reported an uptick of 32% in wireless voice minutes compared to a normal Wednesday before the pandemic. It also mentions a 94% increase in Wi-Fi calling minutes. I found this article to be very cool because of an old innovation becoming a new trend. Thank you, and now to Avery's segment of Here's Something Important.
Hi, everyone. This is Avery again. I will be reporting from the Here's Something Important desk. I would like to pose a question to all of you listeners to think about. How often do you support small businesses owned by people of color? I will be discussing an article written by Joanna Fantozzi from January 12, 2021, titled Starbucks Invests $100 million in Community Resilience Fund to Support Small Businesses Owned by People of Color from National Restaurant News. The main point of the article is that Starbucks will be partnering with community development finance institutions to help with the launch of their Starbucks Community Resilience Fund. This fund is intended to support local businesses in metropolitan areas owned by people of color. The goal for Starbucks is to invest $100 million by the year 2025. I thought this was important to share because it is a direct result of the state of our country right now. Promoting diversity and climate change are huge topics for our country over the past year. I think it is important to praise and identify large companies that are being socially responsible. It's very impressive to me that Starbucks, as large as it is being very progressive when it comes to dealing with these topics. Starbucks is an excellent example of a progressive company heading in the right direction, and is also a great example of what other large companies should be doing, and hopefully they will follow in Starbucks' footsteps. Not only our organizations have to be progressive, you can too. Maybe next time you're craving a coffee, support a local business owned by a person of color. All right, and now on to Corryn for current events on the Here's Something Innovative desk.
Thanks, Avery. Hi, everyone. This is Corryn again, reporting from the Here's Something Innovative desk. The reason I chose this desk in particular is because the hospitality industry is always changing, and I believe it's important to stay up to date with what's going on and industry trends. Today, I'm talking about how Noodles & Co. is making their employees a priority. This article is from October 22nd of 2020 and is titled, Expanded Noodles and Company Benefits Include Pandemic-Inspired Childcare Support and Gender Inclusion Benefits. And it is from Nation's Restaurant News. One innovative thing about this article is that Noodles & Co. is expanding their benefits program to help employees handle working remotely and caring for young children. Their benefit program was already very developed and impressive, but now they're adding about a dozen more perks. This is innovative because they're prioritizing their employees and thinking about what they would want from a benefit program. I think that this is really great because we learned in class from watching the video on REI that having good benefits makes sure that your employees know that they are valued. Another innovative thing Noodles & Company is doing is that they're launching gender inclusion benefits, which provide employees with an option to have pronouns on name tags, and they're bringing gender-neutral bathrooms to all locations. This is innovative because it shows that Noodles & Co. is making diversity and inclusion a priority in their company. And this is great because diversity and inclusion are becoming increasingly more important in HR. With this article in mind, managers should reevaluate their employee benefits and inclusion policies and see what they can do to make them better. This article is a great read because it gives me hope that in the future, we can create better work environments where our employees are happy and feel valued and included. And now on to Alexa, who's going to tell you about something recent that everyone should care about.
Thanks, Corryn. Hey guys, welcome to my segment. Today I'll be discussing how the pandemic has changed the culture and dynamics of our country's workforce forever. I chose this desk because I want to highlight the many important human rights and equality issues going on in our world right now. Furthermore, I want to highlight how these events directly impact the productivity and profitability of our businesses. On December 13th, 2020, Rachel Feitzing published the article, What the Numbers Tell Us About Work Right Now, for the Wall Street Journal. The stats collected in the article show the need for a change in organizational structure and operations to ensure diversity and inclusion. The article stated, despite nearly 500,000 women rejoining the workforce in October, women held 5.5 million fewer jobs that month than they did in February. That being said, the definition of work-life balance has permanently been shifted for everyone, but this does not mean the same thing for men and women. Many managers have a bias towards remote workers and believe in-person employees to be more productive. This is not necessarily true. The more time you spend working does not mean you are more productive. Since women are more likely to work from home after the pandemic, we need to make sure we correct and prevent these biases. The remote work lifestyle has increased employees' clocked hours, but reduced productivity massively. In conclusion, this article shows where HR departments need to focus their efforts to avoid lawsuits and liabilities. Also, this data could help to formulate affirmative action and mental health plans for companies in the future. Diversity and inclusion is our industry's most important asset. We cannot let the pandemic ruin the progress we have made over the years. And now please stay tuned in for Abby's segment, Here's Something You Should Watch Out For.
Thanks, Alexa. Hey everyone, it's Abby and I'll be reporting from the Here's Something to Watch Out For desk. I will be discussing how new regulations can be difficult to enforce with COVID and how some people have gone too far. The article, Here Come the COVID Liability Lawsuits, from January 6, 2021, published in the Wall Street Journal, mentions one thing in the article mentioned is how age discrimination has come about during COVID. Some companies made people who are over the age of 65 work from home. By making them work from home, they're making it harder for them to get promotions or mentoring options because they are not in the office. I feel that if people want to go in the office, they should be allowed to. It should be up to the individual employee to decide if they feel safe enough to be out in public, not their bosses. Another thing mentioned was how hard it is to enforce the mask mandates. People of difficulty breathing conditions are exempt from the mask mandate, but people can lie about having breathing conditions, and employers or businesses cannot ask for medical records to prove this. I think the mask mandate is important, but people should not be lying about having breathing issues to get out of wearing a mask. It makes it harder for those who do have breathing issues to be taken seriously, and it can cause lawsuits to happen. With this in mind, managers should be careful in enforcing certain mandates. They can get in trouble for age discrimination or for mask mandates if not handled properly and have lawsuits against their companies.
Thanks, Abby. Those articles were all so interesting, and I think our common theme is how the pandemic has affected HR, businesses, communications, and operations. Alexa, my article about Noodles & Co. really relates to your article about work-life balance and how companies should look at how to fix this.
I agree with you, Corryn. I look forward to see how our industry recovers from this pandemic in the future. What do you think about this topic, Abby?
I think it'll be interesting to see how companies will end up regulating the vaccine mandates given the mask and work from home mandate troubles now.
I think we can all agree that this pandemic has been very hard on the hospitality industry. However, I think we are all hopeful that some positive will come out of this hardship.
Thank you all for joining us for these updates on human resources. Now on to hot topics.
Hello, everyone, and welcome to our hot topic segment on tattoos in the workplace. My name is Corryn Castello, and I'm the facilitator for the upcoming debate. My job is to structure and guide the overall flow of the dialogue for this debate on tattoos. Tattoos in the workplace is a very interesting and controversial topic. Although I personally do not have any tattoos, I know many people who do, and I think that this is the case for most people. I also think that this topic is relevant to us and HR because it's interesting to see how someone having a tattoo affects the view of a company. Now, let me give you a brief history on tattoos and how having them in the workplace has become controversial. In the years before the 1970s, tattoos were not seen in a good light. In the article from Birdie, Dr. David Lane says that tattooing was used almost exclusively for criminals and prisoners, and it was intentionally designed to mark them as outsiders. This bias about tattoos is one of the things that makes them controversial for the workplace now. Modern tattoos gained popularity as people saw more celebrities and athletes with visible tattoos. Because of these facts, I think it's very important and relevant debate to have. Many people who have tattoos are worried about how people may view them, and companies are worried about how an employee having tattoos will affect the view of their company. Tattoos have been around for a long time, however, they're still controversial. We need to be having more educated conversations about tattoos so that we may be able to find some common ground, which can be helpful to both potential employees and employers. Now we will start off with side one, which is for tattoos in the workplace.
Hi, everyone. We believe that tattoos should be allowed in the workplace because discriminating against tattoos directly affects minority groups. My evidence comes from the opinion article, Stigma Around Tattoos in Professional World, a Form of Workplace Discrimination, from the Collegiate Times, written by Hannah Brown on May 4th, 2018. According to the article, research shows that 38% of Hispanic people have tattoos and 28% of African-American people have tattoos. This is compared to only 22% of Caucasian people having tattoos. Therefore, if employers have strict policies on tattoos in the workplace, potential employees from minority groups could be discriminated against. Discriminating against minorities because of tattoos could be considered a form of disparate treatment because it affects the protected classes. A quote from the article, Argument in the Office, Tattoos in the Workplace, from Daily Nexus, written by Ariana Chameleon and Melanie Zement, exemplifies my argument. Tattoos, regardless of their meaning or presentation, have been historically associated with low social class. This association, rooted in racial and cultural stereotypes, needs to be left in the past. This quote exemplifies that tattoos are often associated with lower social classes, which are often associated with minority groups. Over the summer, history was made with the Black Lives Matter movement. Major companies are changing their policies to support the BIPOC community and encouraging diverse workforces. My question is, if the stigma on tattoos is directly affecting minorities and the BIPOC community, why are companies still discriminating against tattoos? I would now like to pass the mic to Abby to strengthen our argument even more for why tattoos should be allowed in the workplace.
Thank you, Avery. That's a great point. It is definitely something for employers to keep in mind. I think tattoos should be allowed in the workplace because the stigma against tattoos is a generational way of thinking. According to A Tattoo Won't Hurt Your Job Prospects by Allison Beard from Harvard Business Review, Approximately 40% of U.S. households have at least one person with a tattoo, as opposed to the 21% from 1999. She also found out the theory that people are getting tattoos after getting an established career is not true, because a large portion of Generation of Millennials noted getting tattoos in college and still found jobs. Also, according to research from Dana Wilkie in the article, What Are an Applicant's Tattoos Telling Potential Employees, from SHRM, the numbers speak for themselves. About half of millennials and over a third of those belonging to Generation X have at least one tattoo, as opposed to the 13% of baby boomers that have at least one tattoo. The number of people getting tattoos also does not seem like it's going to drop either. So as more generations enter the job market, tattoos are going to have to become more acceptable in the workplace.
Thank you, Abby and Avery, from side one, for your arguments. And now on to side two with Alexa and Evan to hear about the arguments against tattoos in the workplace.
I see the points you are making, side one, but the following arguments will show why tattoos shouldn't be allowed in the workplace. Here's my teammate Evan for the first part of our argument.
Thank you, Alexa. Companies should be against tattoos in the workplace because they do not fit the company's culture or the image they want to portray. Companies have the right to decide whether they want to promote an inclusive or exclusive culture inside the workplace. Rebecca Hastings did a survey titled Tattoos Can Leave Lasting Impressions on March 6, 2012. She says, according to the poll, although 1 in 5 US adults has at least one tattoo, up from 14% in 2003, 45% of the 2016 adults surveyed in January 2012 said people with tattoos are less attractive, 39% said they are less sexy, 27% said they are less intelligent, and 25% said they are less healthy than others. If the company's culture does not meet the preferences and expectations of their patrons, they will never survive. Although younger generations are more accepting and willing to get tattoos, so the boomer generation still holds those deep-rooted negative stereotypes of people with tattoos based on their history and origins. Businesses must take into account the preferences of the large demographic that holds these negative views.
Thank you, Evan. For this part of the argument, I'll be focusing on a different aspect than my peers, the legal side surrounding the issue. Our second stance against tattoos in the workplace is based on the fact that an employee's physical appearance is not a protected class under Title VII in the Civil Rights Act. Therefore, there are no laws prohibiting businesses from discriminating based on a candidate's tattoos. An example of a company that takes physical appearance into account is the restaurant called Hooters. It is stated to be hired, you must be able to maintain the standard weight and appearance. The concept of this business is based upon sex appeal, and it is what drives their business. This discrimination during the hiring process creates the image and experience for Hooters customers that keeps them coming back. Hiring employees with tattoos can affect a business's customer base. Additionally, if a patron believes that those with tattoos are unkempt and distasteful, they are likely to associate those negative ideas with the experience regardless of the quality of the service. Therefore, the court recognizes that employees' appearances can bring hardship to an organization because it shapes a person's perception unconsciously of the establishment and can affect the business's profitability and image as a whole.
Thank you to both sides for presenting their evidence. It was really interesting to hear from all of you. One question I have is for Avery on side one. Diversity in the workplace is a big topic in HR. How does your argument increase diversity in the workplace?
That's a great question, Corryn. Like I mentioned before, there is a much larger percentage of minorities who have tattoos in comparison to Caucasian people who have tattoos. Therefore, if minorities are not hired, it leads to a less diverse workplace. If organizations change their opinions on the stigma, it will only benefit them because they will then have a plethora of personalities and backgrounds to add to their company culture. Organizations who continue to adopt the stigma that tattoos are a bad look are potentially settling for less qualified individuals who won't diversify their company culture, which can only affect the organization negatively.
Thank you for that response. I also have a question for side two. Evan, I really thought your point about how tattoos could be seen as unprofessional and look bad to customers was interesting. Could you tell me more about why a company wouldn't want their employees having tattoos?
Yeah, So at a basic level, I think most companies want their employees to appear a specific way so they meet their business objectives. And if that means they don't want their employees to be showing those tattoos, then they can continue to hire and issue dress codes however they please.
Thank you. That is great input. Alexa, your point that there are no laws prohibiting businesses from discriminating based on a candidate's tattoos is valid. However, have you considered that this may lead to companies missing out on qualified candidates?
Yes, I have considered this. And to elaborate off of Evan's point, it can exclude potential candidates, but businesses do have the right to be as selective in the hiring process as they want. Businesses recognize that their culture is the strongest asset to building and retaining their customer base. By understanding the specifications of their customers, the business can thrive as a whole.
While this is true, as it becomes more common in the younger generations to have tattoos, employers may need to start considering candidates they would be missing out on. Even the Marines now allow visible tattoos.
Thank you, Abby, for that response. I see your side. Overall, I think this was a very meaningful debate on tattoos in the workplace.
I agree. From side one, we heard about Avery about how tattoos should be allowed in the workplace because discriminating against tattoos directly affects minority groups. We also heard from Abby on side one about how they should be allowed in the workplace because the stigma against tattoos is a generational way of thinking. From side two, we were able to hear from Evan about how companies should be against tattoos in the workplace because they may not fit into the company's culture or image. We also heard from Alexa on side two, who talked about how an employee's physical appearance is not protected under Title VII in the Civil Rights Act. We have seen how in the future, there will be more people entering the workplace who have tattoos. Because of this, I think it will be crucial to evaluate candidates well so that they are not being overlooked just because of their tattoo. I also think that the solution depends on the business itself and what they are comfortable with. I think that these were all very strong points. Thank you all so much for presenting your sides, and it will be interesting to see what happens in the future with tattoos in the workplace.
Hello and welcome to the next segment of our podcast we like to call the Real Life Perspective. In this segment, we will be interviewing an industry guest in order to get a different and fresh perspective of someone who is currently in the workforce.
We are honored to have Jasmine Franklin and Nisha Johnson here with us today. Nisha is an English second language teacher and has lots of experience working closely with other teachers and students to ensure her knowledge is taught effectively. Jasmine is currently a global business transformation analyst at Koch Industries, and she is highly skilled in intentional inclusion, talent consultation, and personal development.
Everyone, this is Corryn Castello. We all have a few questions for you about HR and the workplace currently. One question I have is, from your viewpoint, how do you believe the pandemic has changed the workplace most significantly?
Based off of the desperate situation that everyone's in, which is pretty foul in my opinion, as well as you would see how truly dysfunctional the dynamics were truly, really are at the company I was working at. I'm not trying to throw anybody under the bus, but the management really unraveled itself when I was working there. So it shows you that also because people were desperate, they just hired anybody when things start picking up, when money and the cash flow started coming about, the workforce would just hire anyone that had the qualifications without knowing if they were like a real true fit for the company.
Definitely. Mm-hmm. Well, thank you for that input.
Yeah.
All right. What do you think is the most pressing HR issue facing the world of work today?
So I think the most pressing issue is the generational shift. So you have a lot of young people or upper management that are coming in. I believe the younger generation, our generation, more people are educated, and I think we have standards in a sense of, I don't want to tolerate this type of behavior, or I don't want to tolerate being mistreated.
It's like a huge disconnect with like them like wanting traditional standards and then younger kids like trying to change the game, stuff like that. So yeah, I can see that there.
Hi again. The next question kind of elaborates on the last one, and it's beyond monetary compensation. What do you think really motivates employees to stay and perform?
Relationships, the relationship between management and employee. I've been in America for like 3 weeks. So my good friend Alyssa, there's a whole new shift of new employees because our retention rate was low. So everyone, there's 10 people, there's 10 teachers at this private school, 6 out of the 10 left. She was the main one they wanted to keep. And the main reason why she just decided to leave, even when our boss was like, I'll pay you this much, is because the work environment was toxic. All of my friends are leaving, as well as I don't believe management has my best interests. And following what I said before, I think this generation, we prioritize time over money, you know, quality time with people that make you feel good and make you feel motivated, you know, because you can't take back time, right? And I don't want to, and you don't want to be at a workplace where you feel as though you're wasting time or you feel as though you're being mistreated during your time there. So I think that's like the main point where people, where employers get confused at, like, you can't buy my time if other things are falling apart.
I can fully relate to that because two of the jobs that I've had, one of the jobs I liked the tasks less that I was doing, but I felt more valued. And it was more of like a family environment I knew I was cared about. So I stayed there for like 4 or 5 years versus my other job. It was just like a summer job.
Yeah, that's a great question because we don't always have it, right? And everyone is incentivized differently. So you have to look at the individual employee. This is a true philosophy at Coke Industries, which is where I work. And they believe in total compensation for, you know, all of the work that you are contributing. So total contribution for total compensation. So you have to ask your employee, are they really going to have a hard time? So let's talk about rescinded offers. Some students, maybe your peers, maybe experienced this where they had an offer, but then the company had to take it away because of pandemic impacts, right? So when we looked at that, guess who had to make all of those calls? The recruiters that hired them. So we weren't able to save all of the roles. We were able to save a bulk of the roles that were going to continue to add value, but we really had to look to see, you know, where is this person going to be set up for success after their training program or after their internship as well. So I knew our recruiters were going to be, our morale is going to be really down. So I spoke with the other early career leaders and said, you know, how can we show our appreciation for them? So we were able to offer them a free PTO day for mental health. And then we also gave them a coffee gift card as well, because, you know, everyone loves coffee, at least our team does. So taking time to get to know your employees is really important, because if no one drank coffee, then of course that wouldn't be a good one. Or if we felt like, okay, this isn't really going to impact in the way that we want it to, you could always choose a different way. So I would say non-incentivized, think of other benefits that you're getting from your company.
And then one question I have is, what advice do you have for college students today entering the workforce, and what sets of skills should college students be focusing on developing?
All right. So my first advice is, know your self-worth, know your values, know what you can bring to the table, because the best advice I can give to anyone is that people will treat you the way you will. People will treat you the way that you allow them to treat you, right? So if you allow them, you allow someone to treat you badly, they're gonna continue to do so, to continue to take advantage. So all of you, please know your self-worth, all right? Don't settle, because the jobs need you more than you need them, right? They need these employees to keep it operating. So I would say that, and my second skill that you should continue on is to be open-minded. My major is hospitality management. I minor in business, and I'm doing teaching. Like I graduated. I worked at a Cozy. I was a manager at a Cozy. Didn't like it. I worked at this weird taco Korean fusion place. Didn't like it. I'm like, you know what? I've been dying to teach and travel. I followed that. So just be open to different opportunities. Know your self-worth, know your value. And I would say listening, because listening is like the biggest power you can have. Listening and being open to learn, because we all don't know everything. So I have a lot of stuff I have to tell you. All right. So that's like my three major things. Know your worth. Listening skills are important, and just be open. Stay open-minded to different opportunities that may come your way.
It'll definitely help, especially since I am graduating. I'll take that with me.
Yes.
Hi, I'm...
Hey, so for Jasmine, workplace diversity is a very important issue for many companies. From a particular standpoint, what policies and strategy can make the workplace more inclusive?
Okay, perfect. So I want to be cautious around the word policy, especially around inclusion, because I think it starts with inclusion for employers, right? The reason why you chose Penn State and the reason why you're going to choose a company is because you have that feeling that you're really going to be able to make a difference. So I would say some practical things that companies can do are, first, doing an analysis on what policies or guidelines do they have today that might be closing barriers. So for one example, is GPA a requirement to apply for that role? When else do we use GPA outside of internship roles? Never in the real world, right? So we actually took this out for the company that I'm working for now. We took out GPA requirements. You know, it shows that you're a good test taker. It doesn't necessarily show that you can apply the knowledge that you have. So we believe in behavior-based interviews, do the best job at that. Also within diversity and inclusion, how are you setting those candidates or employees up for success? So do you have resources for them that are available? And in what way are you providing upskilling? So we talked about being agile and being able to adapt in many different ways, but are we providing them with resources to do that? So I think that is really important. So one, looking at the barriers that are indirectly included in companies and removing them if possible, right? And then the second is, what are the resources that they have available?
Yeah, that's really great insight. We learn about this in class a lot, but sometimes, you know, you don't really know what's best to do because there's so much information. So it's really great to hear from you, who's out working in the real world right now and has seen things work and things that don't work. So that's really great.
Thank you guys so much for all the insightful answers that you gave us. We truly appreciate your time. We do have one more question for you both. What are some of your favorite Penn State memories?
Spoken to a one last week or a couple weeks ago, and I took the time to have fun classes my last semester. So I took sailing, believe it or not. Our final was in the Florida Keys, and I did my 4:30 class the first semester. So I highly suggest that for any of those who are planning out their year. But that was such a great time to bond with everyone and learn so much about the restaurant world and being a leader.
Just eating, laughing after a long day of serving people and getting to know our guests and customers, being in the fine dining, having a small, tiny bite of what fine dining is supposed to look like. And that was like probably like my favorite memory. It's beautiful.
Well, thank you so much both for speaking with us and participating in the Real World Perspective segment of our podcast. And we hope you both have a great rest of your day.
Thank you to everyone who has listened to our podcast. It was truly an experience that we will remember as we begin our professional careers.
We would also like to thank our guest interviewees, Jasmine and Naisha, for their insight on HR topics.
Throughout this podcast, we've learned lots about human resources, beginning with Here's the News and continuing to the Hot Topics debate about tattoos and finishing off with the real world perspective. It was great to hear different views about HR topics and get some tips from professionals.
We hope you've learned something new today, whether it's from our headlines, hot topics, or our guests, Jasmine and Aisha. I know my group members and I have, and we're thankful to have these insightful conversations with our guests.
Thank you again for joining us. This is Abby with Evan, Avery, Corryn, and Alexa, and we hope to see you on the next episode about company culture and why it's important.